So in my last video, where I briefly touched upon various innovations, concepts, and natural wonders that are associated with Britain, one thing I curiously forgot to mention was the royal family. And since I'm a British nationalist through and through, it would be remiss if I didn't give my thoughts on the monarchy, and of course, the coronation, which happened last week. Now I'll admit, I'm torn when it comes to the royal family. On the one hand, I idolise everything they represent. The royal family represents an unbroken chain going back thousands of years to William the Conqueror, Æthelstan of Wessex, to England's foundation as a country. England and the royal family are inseparable. Doesn't get much more English than that. It feels great being a citizen who has roots on this island that has for over 1,000 years been ruled by a dynasty of chieftains, warriors and aristocrats who are born to lead a life of example, virtue and excellence. Of course, maybe this is a little romanticism on my part, but regardless, I have tremendous respect for the things that have existed for hundreds of years and never changed. Perhaps one of the most unique things about our country is the fact that even in this day and age, where liberal democracies and constitutional diets are the norm, we still have a monarchy. Many countries have overthrown theirs in a violent revolution and have an entire constitution framed within the context of breaking free from their power. But sadly, like many of our sacred institutions that have existed since time immemorial, the royal family has been corrupted by modern politics, especially since the 20th century. This change in attitude is increasingly pervasive. You can see it every time a royal festivity is shown on television. Ever since the collapse of our empire, the royal family have effectively become ambassadors of the new image of multicultural Britain. In fact, if you take a look, you'll see that through the years, Queen Elizabeth and other members of the royal family have given speeches in which they've denounced nationalism and paid clear lip service to what we now recognise as pro-multiculturalist, pro-globalist sentiments.
Parliamentary institutions, with their free speech and respect for the rights of minorities, and the inspiration of a broad tolerance in thought, all this we conceive to be a precious part of our way of life and outlook.
Indeed, it means nothing at all unless the Brotherhood, starting with individuals, can reconcile rival communities, conflicting religions, differing races, and the divided and prejudiced nations of the world. The British people, together, have achieved great things in the past, but we cannot make further progress if we resurrect ancient squabbles.
Notwithstanding the strains and stresses of nationalism, different cultures and religions, and its growing membership, the Commonwealth family has still managed to hold together and to make a real contribution to the prevention of violence and discord.
Every religion has something to say about tolerance and respecting others. The implication drawn by Jesus is clear. Everyone is our neighbour, no matter what race, creed, or colour. There is certainly much more to be done. Discrimination still exists. Some people feel that their own beliefs are being threatened. They all need to be reassured that diversity is indeed a strength and not a threat. We need also to realize that peaceful and steady progress in our society of differing cultures and heritage can be threatened at any moment by the actions of extremists at home or by events abroad.
Sadly, that is also the case of members of the Windrush generation, who were victims of racism when they arrived here, and discrimination remains an all too familiar experience for black men and women in Britain in 2022. Diversity is what makes us strong, and it is what reflects the modern, outward-looking values that are so important to our country.
Whereas the royal family used to connote our empire, the stoic gravitas of our upper class, our excellence as a people, our competence in ruling the entire world, our Promethean gifts we bestowed upon the world's civilizations. Nowadays, each time a royal event takes place, it is now showcased as an example of how tolerant and inclusive we are as a nation, how welcoming we are towards peoples of different cultures and faiths, and how we'd essentially be nothing without them. And this is what I find difficult to appreciate about the state of our current monarchy. Like everything else, our police, our state media, our education, our church, our ruling class, it has been hijacked and corrupted by our enemies. Yet in spite of this, even now, a great deal of people in Britain still have unyielding faith in the monarchy and worship them fanatically. I suppose it is nice to see. There is something quite remarkable, to be honest, about how throngs of tens of thousands would willingly gather in the rain on their own 2 feet just to witness them go about their royal duties. But sadly, I don't think it's real. It's all pomp and circumstance, and it's totally empty of real meaning. It's meaningless if our king, emblazoned in his royal regalia, with his scepter and his crown, continues to fiddle while our country slowly dies from 1,000 cuts due to multiculturalism and progressive ideology. Especially since, during this coronation, it seemed like even the most mundane of procedural minutiae seemed to hammer this point home. We saw a black priest, a woman priest, a black woman priest, and there was this. What is this, Harry and Meghan's wedding again? Is this going to be a regular thing from now on? As if that wasn't enough, they even found the time to include this Indian Sikh, dressed like Father Christmas, present the king with the coronation glove. Just what is going on? And of course, the ceremony featured outspoken pro-refugees activist Archbishop Justin Welby, who luckily for us this time did not take the opportunity to make a speech about diversity and inclusion. Also, for some strange reason, the Golden State carriage was drawn by horses who had blue hair. It's a mystery even now why that decision was made. For some reason, when I saw those blue-haired horses, I couldn't look at that and not think of people like this. I wonder if those horses have an account on TikTok. I wonder what it would look like. Maybe something like this.
Day one of being a Golden State Coach horse, I drew the king and queen with my 7 friends from Westminster Abbey to Buckingham Palace. I was originally worried that someone in the crowd would incorrectly assume my gender. But then I remembered, I've been neutered anyway, so it doesn't matter. As soon as my ride was over, I was taken to the spa, given a free manicure for my overworked hoofs, and helped myself to some vegan gluten-free grass. We have a very chill and non-judgmental vibe at our stables, where we can always discuss our mental health issues with the local stable boy / counselor.
But in spite of my misgivings, I still watched the ceremony all the same. We went as a family and saw it with our grandparents, who are from a totally different generation and a lot more old school, and who still admire and worship the royal family. And I enjoyed it, for the most part. To his credit, I've always been suspicious of King Charles, his careless treatment of Diana, and ever since that minor scandal back in 1994 in which he threatened to abandon his title of Defender of the Faith and change it to Defender of Faith. But to my pleasant surprise, he embraced the title as our king.
Will you to the utmost of your power maintain in the United Kingdom the Protestant Reformed religion established by law? Will you maintain and preserve inviolably the settlement of the Church of England?
All this I promise to do.
And as a lover of all things historic, the interior shots of Westminster Abbey, with the golden plates and royal jewellery, the choral arrangement, even though it was some of the worst Latin I've ever heard.
By that,
were very enchanting. We popped some champagne and sat through the entire event, although we did stop watching for Camilla's coronation. But there are 2 things specifically that happened during the ceremony which I want to discuss in this video. First of all, the BBC, as I predicted, did its usual thing of inviting these politically appointed high priests of the new religion of diversity and inclusion, granting them an undeserved platform to deconstruct and debase the royal family and our national history. First, we saw this black guy with a UK passport give his opinion on the matter. Here's what he said.
At the last coronation, there was an imperial presence. The last queen became queen of what was still an empire. This transformation into a commonwealth and this representation today is a very unlikely next chapter in the story of the empire. I don't think anyone sitting here in 1953 could have imagined this new relationship, this new set of relationships that we have today. The presence of the soldiers from the commonwealth, I think, as you say, it is about recognizing a history that was, I'm very sad to say, quite deliberately erased for many years. And it's wonderful to see, not just here, but at the Cenotaph, to see the Commonwealth recognised as a partner in those great conflicts of the 20th century.
Now, I personally didn't see a lot of Commonwealth soldiers during the ceremony. Most of them were white. But to be honest, I don't really have that much of a problem with them taking part in the festivities anyway, since they do symbolise the global reaches of our imperial conquest and our greatness as a nation and an empire. But what needs to be understood here is that he's saying more than we think he is. Notice how here, when he says the word Commonwealth, he's using it as a euphemism.
This transformation into a Commonwealth.
And it becomes clear, when he talks about them being erased for many years, that what he's actually referring to is, of course, people from the former empire. That is, ethnic minority British subjects.
It is about recognising a history that was, I'm very sad to say, quite deliberately erased for many years.
He's using this to aggrandise their achievements, their presence in our empire and our national tapestry. I took the time to look up this guy, and it seems like my instincts were right on the money. This is David Olusoga, a Nigerian-born professor of public history. Except, that's not quite right. A woke propagandist who, due to neither merit nor popular demand, is suddenly appearing on our television lecturing us about our history. And for reasons totally non-partisan and not born out of politically correct favouritism, was somehow given a BAFTA award, proving just how badly our state broadcaster loves to fawn over these people. I don't care to delve too deeply into his success, but you can take a glance at this book he's published and draw your own conclusions about who he is and what he represents. I did some research into his background, and it turns out this isn't the first time he's given his pro-multiculturalist views on the monarchy. He appeared in that Netflix Meghan and Harry documentary. And if you guys pay me £1 million, maybe, just maybe, one day, I might actually watch it. He has iterated the same tired talking points that are shared by all in our elite London neoliberal bubble, stating further that the coronation has been a huge effort to show the diversity of faith within Britain. And earlier in January, he even described the Windrush, the beginning of Britain's undoing as an empire and a nation-state, and one of the worst things to happen to London since the Luftwaffe bombings, as a success story.
The communities that have developed from that moment, the black community, is one of the most diverse, one of the most integrated communities, one of the great success stories of Britain. This is, they've helped create modern Britain. Just look at the England football team that we've just cheered on in the World Cup. That is a story of diversity.
So of course the BBC felt the need to have this revisionist appear on their show. They sure never miss an opportunity to knock down and delegitimize our accomplishments and our identity as a people. But you see, the BBC has long since shirked their duties as our national broadcaster to educate, inform us, and unify us as a country. Now they exist purely to denigrate and unwind our sense of national pride, to bastardize it by exaggerating the accomplishments of foreigners, and to advance their despicable pro-state, neoliberal, woke capitalist propaganda. Indeed, they're already so far gone, to be honest, it would have been surprising if they didn't choose to feature such an individual on their show. And nor were they the only ones to do this. ITV, another one of our public service broadcasters, did the same. At one point during the ceremony in which Charles and Camilla waved to thousands of onlookers with the RAF doing their flypast, they invited Will Smith's wife here to give her own vacuous opinion, in which she casually opined about how terribly white the balcony at Buckingham Palace was.
It's a bit of me that we've gone from the rich diversity of the Abbey to a terribly white balcony. I'm very struck by that.
Yes, I know. It's infuriating. The fact that Britain is overwhelmingly white and has always been since we even existed as a country. And so is our royal family. Why can't Britain just be full of black people and genderqueer lesbians instead? And while we as British people have grown quite indifferent towards this open bigotry towards our race in recent years, mainly due to how often we keep getting exposed to it,
I have never seen so many white people in one place.
This was different. These comments were made on live television during a special day of jubilation, national and historical pride, with millions of fellow countrymen watching. And sadly for her, it turns out that the vast majority of British people watching ITV's televised footage of the coronation in real time happened to be white. And suffice it to say, they did not take too kindly to her thinly veiled prejudice. In fact, Ofcom received over 4,000 complaints for this fiasco, making it the most complained about event on British television of 2023. Well done. We're not even halfway through the year yet. And if ITV were truly beholden to their stakeholders and cared about what we, the British public, thought, they would learn from this, make a public apology for hosting her on their show, and vow never to invite her again. But I have my doubts. Any responsible news organisation that had the best interests of the British people at heart would have never invited this revolting bull dyke onto our television. The haircut alone was a clear sign that there'd be trouble coming from a mile off.
Warning. Warning. Leftist alert. Repeat. Leftist cunt alert.
Nobody asked for her opinion. I don't know who this woman is, nor do I care to know. She'll likely be forgotten once all the anger and hatred dies down. But ITV have not apologised for exposing us to this lethal dose of brain pollution, and likely never will. But there's one more thing in particular, related to the coronation, that I need to discuss. Before the coronation started, these jokers, anti-monarchists, saw this as the perfect opportunity to garner some publicity and protest in favour of abolishing our monarchy during the coronation. Now, what are my thoughts on this? Should we abolish our monarchy? Now, I can understand, on the one hand, why many people are unenthusiastic about the current state of our monarchy. King Charles, frankly, doesn't command the same level of respect that his mother did. I always got the impression that he was, as a young man, and even now, a weak-minded man who is too emotional and lacking in conviction to do what needs to be done. And the way he treated his wife, Princess Diana, was unforgivable. And then, of course, don't even get me started on Camilla or Tampon Gate. Ugh, the less said about that, the better. And I've already expressed my displeasure at how even our beloved royal family has become corrupted over time, like all our other institutions, and subscribes to the new state dogma of multiculturalism and tolerance. But that doesn't mean I believe the monarchy should be abolished. Far from it. I'm proud to call myself British. I love what they represent, and I am outraged when people criticize or insult the legacy of our kingdom or our royal family. As far as I'm concerned, anyone who insults the royal family insults me as well. To paraphrase Joker from The Dark Knight, it's not about the monarch, it's about sending a message.
It's not about money, it's about sending a message.
What matters to us is not who the king or queen is, but what they represent. And what do they represent? Tradition, aristocracy, nobility, history, class. If you abolish our royal family, you may as well abolish Westminster Abbey, and all the churches and the pubs in this entire country. And you already know my feelings on that. So that's why I could never even countenance the idea of us getting rid of our royal family, let alone becoming another gay liberal republic, like so many other countries have done. Anyway, going back to this story, who are these anti-monarchists? What do they stand for? Why do they want the monarchy abolished? Well, they are exactly who I expected. Labour Party supporters. Socialists. And their anti-monarchy stance intersects neatly with all the other rotten anti-British ideas that I cannot stomach. Calling Meghan Markle the people's princess. Yeah, you've lost me already. In this Times interview with these clowns, we learn that their arguments in favour of removing the royal family are the same predictable, vapid talking points that we've been hearing for the past century and honestly aren't any more new or relevant now than they were back then. He's not elected.
I don't believe in people who aren't elected having positions of power.
I believe in democracy, and monarchy is by its very nature undemocratic.
There's inequality in this country.
Inequality is a huge problem in this country at the moment, and they epitomise inequality.
There's snobbery.
There's classism and snobbery in this country.
The cost to the taxpayer.
I think this coronation is a disgusting waste of an estimated £250 million.
And since I'm paying approximately £5 for this coronation today, I feel I've got just as much right to come here as the royalists who have paid their £5.
£9 billion a year, and they pay no tax on it.
I'm so sick and tired of hearing this argument. It just lacks perspective. There's not a single ceremony, act of parliament, or initiative put into place by any government that does not consume some amount of taxpayer money. What matters is, are we happy footing the bill for this? Is there anything more important and beneficial to us that urgently requires more government spending that would justify the slash in funding for this significant royal event? The answers to both, by the way, are yes and no, respectively. See, these people exhibit a trait that I feel is common amongst the left. They seem to inherently dislike any notion of hierarchy. They are offended at the idea that some individuals, from birth, are born into greater power, prestige, ability, competence, or intelligence than others. They dislike this because they see it as unfair. But what they fail to realise is, we weren't the ones who invented this law. It's always been there. Virtually every complex society in history up until the 20th century has had a royal family. Monarchy is simply a recognition of that natural law. And even though our monarchy hasn't had any real authority since the English Civil War, he still remains a powerful figurehead for our identity. He's symbolic of our nation. Not that you people would care, because you most likely have no real affection for our country in the first place and would happily like to see it abolished as well. In particular, we saw this one noisy, attention-seeking organisation called Republic at the fore of all this nonsense. I took the time to take a careful look at their website to see what they're all about, and they are just as revolting as I imagined. They are globalists who have a vision for our country that involves abolishing not just the royal family, but any sense of nationhood and pride we have in our country. In their statement of principles, they state the following: the rights of citizens must apply equally, without distinction of any kind, such as race, colour, sex, disability, sexual orientation, language, religion, political or other opinion, national or social origin, property, birth, or other status. Notice how it says here, the rights of citizens must apply equally without any distinction of race or even national origin. In other words, under a constitution like this, basically anyone could be a British citizen. It doesn't take a huge stretch of the imagination to know what vision they have for the future of this country. They want a borderless, classless, global, multicultural Britain. Now, maybe you think I'm reading a bit too much into this, but from my point of view, it's clear that they want to do away with not just the British monarchy, but any notion of what it means to be British at all. But if you think their leftist, globalist leanings weren't transparent enough already, in another section of their website, The Truth About the Royals, they write this drivel. There is a long history of racism within the British royal family, from involvement with the transatlantic slave trade, to support for Nazism to Meghan Markle's allegations about comments made by a royal about her child's skin colour. When it comes to their own behaviour or their family's past, the royals make no effort to address these issues, whether it's everyday racism, structural racism, slavery, empire, the realities of multi-ethnic Britain, there it is, and their role amongst it all. The topic of racism in the monarchy clearly makes some uncomfortable, and so it is often difficult to have an open and honest conversation about it. Racism is a complex problem within our society, and the royal family has a long history of turning a blind eye to it, and in some circumstances, enabling it. Undoubtedly, racism has been allowed to flourish within the House of Windsor, and none of us should allow this to continue. The royal family must be held accountable for their behaviour. They are leftist, globalist sympathisers who reject our history and our traditions and our definition as a people. They're people who I cannot say I admire greatly or sympathise with. So as you can imagine, the world's smallest violin must have been playing on the morning of May the 6th when these globalists were swiftly dealt with and arrested by Metropolitan Police. It's not as though they weren't warned. The police publicly announced that there would be zero tolerance for protests during the coronation, and that protesters would be met with swift action. You know something? For all their flaws, it looks like the police can actually carry out their duty and deal with troublemakers when the situation requires it. Well done to them, I say. Which brings me now over to the issue of free speech. Days after the arrest, their ill-conceived publicity stunt was all over mainstream news. Articles were being written, sympathising with their plight, wondering what had happened to freedom of speech. The Guardian called it an attack on democracy. Pardon me if I don't shed a tear. Let me make one thing clear. I am not a libertarian. I don't believe in freedom of speech. In practice, I believe it's neither sustainable nor desirable to uphold. Why grant freedom of speech to people who fundamentally have no respect for your existence? As a matter of fact, throughout our history, we've allowed all kinds of unsavory and toxic ideas to flourish throughout the 20th century, which we've misguidedly blessed under the aegis of freedom of expression, and in the many years since then, they've matured into the monstrosities that they are now. Gay rights, feminism, liberalism, anti-racism, Marxist critical theory. These are the many problems we've allowed to grow to significant proportions that in hindsight we could have easily resolved long ago by stamping them out and nipping them in the bud. This is Realpolitik. Speech is a form of power. Why give power to your enemies? If a certain group of people's ideas aren't met with resistance or challenge to curb the extent of their influence, they will inevitably spread. And even the most unsound and anti-scientific of nonsense can cultivate a steady following if the right people support it and no form of counter-protest is allowed. Like weeds, they need to be uprooted and dealt with before they grow. And that is why I support the actions of Metropolitan Police in dealing with these idiots. However, one thing that does concern me about this is the alarming amount of free publicity they got as a result. I've been seeing their ads on YouTube, for God's sake. Let me ask you this. Supposing we right-wingers, nationalists or conservatives, were holding a protest of our own, and we were dealt with by the police in a similar fashion, arrests and imprisonment, do you think that we could expect the same kind of sympathy from them? Do you think anyone gives a damn about our rights to freedom of speech? Absolutely not. This phony display of outrage by the left is completely disingenuous and fabricated. As far as they're concerned, freedom of speech only matters if it's something that affects their interests or people on their side. Look at this. This is Anna Soubry, former MP for Broxtowe and leader of pro-Remainer group, Independent Group for Change. In 2019, she was confronted by pro-Brexit protesters who weren't exactly happy with her outspoken attempts at interference with our democratic EU referendum, calling her a traitor.
Traitors like you were told what the people feel.
You are a traitor. You are a traitor to this country.
The protesters who challenged her were arrested by the police and sentenced to 28 days in prison for harassment, even though none of their actions that day meet the legal definition of the word. Yet now, nearly 4 years later, here she is in this tweet decrying the actions of the police in arresting these protesters. So in other words, freedom of speech, but only for the right kind of people.
A very small group of people who are roaming around Westminster, intimidating people going about their lawful business. It's very, very different to the undoubted abuse that if other people, and it's a known group, I would expect the authorities to intervene when it's clearly crossed the line.
You see, they understand the true nature of the game and how it's played. Freedom of speech is an expression of power. You don't want your enemies to have power. And for the past few decades, we on the right have been losing power. Freedom of speech has become a trademark rallying cry almost exclusively for those of us on the right, because we are the ones who are most often on the receiving end of censorship. That's why all of this stinks phony outrage to me. What's going on is that the left are trying to weaponize our own right-wing sensitivities against us. They're trying to appeal to our own sense of morality, even though they have zero respect for us when we do the same. So all in all, the coronation remains a shining example of how British identity and national pride have been co-opted and used for nefarious means. The people continue to worship what is now a pantomime, becoming devoted to symbolic national icons, and yet ignoring the real issues, the real problems. It seems like celebration of the royal family seems to be, in this day and age, the last remaining strand of nationalism that is acceptable in our country nowadays. Who can say for how much longer it will last? However, I for one, in spite of everything, remain a staunch monarchist and wish that our monarchy, like the other corrupted elements of our ruling class, will be set straight one day and defend and protect real British values. And lastly, one thing of course before I forget, God save the King, and thank you for watching this video.